these are, you know, ideas about what is and what's possible. And I find that the most inspiring and most useful for me as a healer, to, because I'm always looking for, well, what are the answers that we don't know? How do we help someone who's not healing? We're doing everything we know, and yet there isn't a restoration of health. There isn't a miraculous healing. How do miracles work? How do we create? I'd like to see miraculous healings. You know, we want to heal people faster, easier, instantaneous. That's what we all want. So I don't know how to get there. I'm trying to find it. I'm searching. This is me searching to how does this work? But what if you're just at the level of, I don't even know if, you know, what I'm doing wrong. How do I know what I should stop doing that I'm doing? How do I know what to start doing? I hear about 1,000 things that are supposed to be bad. How could I possibly even, I don't have enough brain power or time in the day or money to avoid 10% of those things. And then there's another 1,000 things that are supposed to be good for me. Again, I don't have enough understanding of which one might be better for me, or enough money to buy them, or, you know, where can I start if I really, I want to heal myself? Maybe all I know, maybe who we need to speak to right now, is if you are frustrated with trying to be healthy. It's like, how come, you know, maybe when I was younger, my body seemed to just get over things, it healed things. And as we get older, our body doesn't heal so fast. And in fact, we associate getting old with aging, with falling apart, with entropy, with dissipation of our life force and our ability to restore health and order and function in the body. So that's, there are many things to understand, but we can also chunk that down into a few key critical things that we can do that will make a big difference. It's kind of the 80-20 rule. There's, you know, if I can take 20% of the things that I could do that would be good for me, or 20% of the things that I could avoid that are bad for me, that get 80% of the results, well, that's a starting point to look at.
What are those 20%?
Well, and we can even break it down
generally,
further.
You
that
know,
same rule
would be the water, right?
That same rule is a general rule, so it applies to the 20%. So let's take that 20% of things, which is still a lot. Maybe over time, yes, that could be a goal, to implement the 20% of things that get 80% of the job done, and maybe that's enough for you, maybe for many people. But if we start with the 20% of the 20%, so we have 4%, that's much more manageable. That's like what we know about the universe. The scientists say is 4%. So, hey, let's start there with the 20% of the 20% that gets 80% of the 80% of the job done. So it gets most of the job done, almost 2/3, 64%.
Okay, so what is it?
Yeah, so what is that?
How do we find that out?
That's... if it's 4%, maybe we can talk about maybe 4 things.
Okay.
For those 4%.
Cool.
You know, one of them has to be, why did I create the 5 phases of health, model of health? That's one of those, has to be one of those. If we have just a handful of things, 4 or 5 things, the 5 phases of health is your roadmap. Because moving from where you are now of not being satisfied with your health and your self-healing process, your speed of healing, or the fact that you're going the wrong direction, getting less healthy, less functional with age, with time, you need to know where you're at and where you're going. We need orientation. Where am I? Where are you? If you have chronic degenerative disease going on, then you're in phase 1. Well, okay, that's a starting point. I know where I am on this map, on this 5 levels of health, 5 phases of health. You're at this basic starting point, phase 1, and there's certain things to understand and to do, you can do about that. If you're in phase 2, maybe you're dealing with enzymes that don't work. You're not digesting well. Maybe you're working with bacteria. You, instead of your own cells thriving, you have the wrong bacteria. You have infection, bacterial infections happening, or parasites. At phase three, maybe you have fungal issues. At phase four, maybe there's allergic symptoms, or you feel toxic. At phase five, you're dealing with stress and hormonal issues and life stresses. People and money and job and culture and emotions.
Cool.
So
I like that. Have a roadmap.
Yeah. Then we can get practical on, instead of talking about the 10,000 things or the 1,000 things or the 100 things, there's a few things to explore that help most people.
Yeah, and it's very helpful to know this map, because what you've said in the past about, 100% of cases of remission from cancer, total remission from cancer overnight.
Mm-hmm. Or in a few days,
or
usually.
In a few days, okay. Yep. That there was phase two.
Phase two.
So phase one is the cancer area, yep. The viral area. Phase two is the bacterial area, and that's where you're going to see fevers and you're going to see bacterial infections and that kind of thing. Yeah. And if you don't suppress that, then that is part of the cure for cancer then.
It's the natural cure for cancer is our own immune system, mm-hmm. and that can be triggered by bacteria. We get a fever, a high fever. The fever is not the bacteria, it's us. It's our immune system,
right.
It's our body creating that fever, and it increases our metabolism, increases our immunity, and in a short time it can have major effect. It's not a miracle, it's just a natural process that is not well enough understood, because there's no funding to study it. They call it spontaneous. Well, that's like saying it's random. It's spontaneous generation, it just happened. Nothing caused it. There is
none
no
of
process of causality.
Cause
right. There's no drug that causes it, so it's spontaneous, and we don't study it. So, yeah, that's a key element. There's different technologies that would be key, if you can, to implement in those, for dealing with those different phases. There's key remedies and supplements that are critical, crucial, and help almost everyone who's in that situation. So these are sort of the baseline of your health program can start with these fundamental changes in your internal and external environment that, we know now in the last 10 years, modern science is talking about the environment affecting the cells. You know, before that, for decades, it was all the idea that it's all controlled by the genes. It's all genetic, and we're just learning about that. You know, whatever we focus our mind on, that's all we see. If we're not thinking about another factor, it's out of sight, out of mind. And so that's how our science is, because it is all science is our awareness, but it's organized, structured, and we structure our interaction with the world to try to understand the world and how we can interact with, how we can control it.
I like what you've said in the past about that if somebody is, say, in phase four, where they're dealing with some allergies and they're sneezing, and where if they're able to be supported in whatever that toxicity is, getting it out, then they're headed in the direction of phase five.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if they use suppressive medicine, such as antihistamines, or with asthma, you use one of those
inhalers, steroids.
Then you're suppressing and end up going into phase three or phase two.
Or phase one.
Or phase one. Yeah.
That's why, the over-the-counter antihistamines for allergy symptoms in the sinus increase the risk of cancer in the sinuses and in the brain, because the body is attempting to locally detoxify, and we're pushing that back in. We're suppressing the immune function. We're stopping it from getting stuff out, and now it goes into storage, and that's all cancer is a storage of toxins.
Yeah, so it's so useful to have this roadmap, because then when symptoms come up, you can look at the, you know, the documentation on what happens in phase 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, mm-hmm. what kind of symptoms you're going to see, what, you know, maybe you got some kind of exposure, you didn't really think that was going to be a big deal, and sure enough, you get this reaction a little while down the road after that.
Or a long while. Yeah. Maybe decades later.
Right.
I've had multiple patients that smelled ether, and the people around them smelled ether for a few days after starting a new program that was an individual program, which we'll talk about as, you know, another level, a higher level solution, higher level of support, but where we actually ask your body, we look at what your body is doing right now to heal itself. We analyze that. I call it biofield analysis, and we've also added some other technical systems for energetic analysis of the body to supplement my own system. But for 27 years, we've been doing that.
Those are really cool. I like those. I like the NASS
and the Zyto.
Seeing how that comes in.
And they add additional treatment modalities as well, which has been really wonderful to explore systems that other healers have developed over the last 30 years, primarily, really the last 60 years, this field of energy medicine has been progressing.
Okay, so we've got the number one of those four you were thinking of is having that roadmap, having your map. It's kind of like if you're going to go on a journey, which is journey of life, first thing you probably want is a map. What's the next thing?
I think the next has to be the road signs. You got to be able to read the signs along the road to know if you're, again, going the right, am I on the path? You know, is this pothole I'm off the road, or just...
Yeah. What's a good example of a road sign that we would be looking
like
at?
Like a fever.
Okay,
I have a fever. What is that? What does that mean? Is that... We're so indoctrinated in the idea that a symptom is the problem, rather than seeing it as a sign of activity of our healing systems. Our healing system is doing something. Do we want to stop that sign of healing? And if we're stopping the sign of healing, does it mean we're stopping the healing? We have to. Those are the questions we have to ask.
So are you saying that the road signs are the symptoms?
The road signs are the symptoms. That's how we can... How do we know if we're having a disease crisis or a healing crisis?
So what's the difference between having road signs and having the road map? Why would those two be
the
different?
The road map is like, where am I? What road am I on?
And how would you determine that? Wouldn't it be by the road signs?
There are a number of ways of determining it, but yeah, we can... The road sign says highway, you know, 131. I know, I'm on that highway. Or sign says entering the town of phase 2, you know.
And the map is supposed to be a representation of the terrain.
The terrain.
Right. I don't see the difference between the road. Because I'm thinking about myself going on a hike out into the wilderness, the back country.
Yep.
And I'm going to want to have my map. So I'm going to want to have my compass. I'm going to have my water and food, my nutrients.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the compass is the signs of orientation. Which direction am I moving? I'm here on the map. Maybe I don't. I'm in phase 2 on the map. But am I in a healing crisis where some unknown, you know, small tumor is in my colon that I wouldn't find out clinically is there for another 10 years maybe, is going away with this fever? Or does the fever mean, I've maybe slipped into phase 1 and it's a viral fever and I need to, you know, like get my energy back up to level 2, phase 2? Or does it mean I have a disease crisis and I might die of this bacterial infection that's going to get into my heart and stop my heart and I'm dead? That's critical to know. And without the compass, we don't know. We have an idea of where we are on the map. The road sign system is what we call regulation. How is your body regulating? It's kind of like the lights on the dashboard. Of the car, it's like, ooh, there's a red light on.
Right.
Is it an electrical problem? Is it a problem with the thing that's measuring? Is it a problem, you know, what's going on? So in regulation, we also have a scale of 5 to see how you're doing. at the bottom of the scale, at the worst end of the scale, you'd never know, if you don't know this about road signs, you'd think that you're doing great. You think, here you are, you're headed on the highway onto a bridge that they didn't finish constructing, or that a segment of the bridge fell out with an earthquake. So you're heading along thinking, wow, this is open highway, I can go nice and fast, this is awesome, I'm doing great, I'm headed somewhere, I don't have a map, I don't know where I'm going, or I'm not reading road signs, I don't know, you know, what's ahead. So I didn't read that sign says bridge closed, that it's, you know, that the middle section is out. So when we're not reading the road signs, when there are no road signs even, that's level one. That's blocked regulation, where systems are down, they're not working. Like our system to be able to respond to invasion of toxins and other biological entities with an immune response, a fever, flu response, a cleansing reaction. If we don't have enough energy, if we're in low energy terrain of phase one, we don't have enough energy to do that. In the upper levels of phase one, we could have a low fever with a viral infection. We don't have enough energy around ourselves to structure the water, to keep viruses away from the cell membrane so they can attach the membrane, get in the cell. Cell responds to that genetic material and reproduces the virus. So
that's blocked regulation.
So that's blocked regulation, where systems are down, they're not working, and so we don't feel any, we don't see any signs of healing processes, which are symptoms. So we're kind of symptom-free. People who come in that are usually shocked that they have cancer say, I was the healthiest person around that I know for 20 years. I never even got the flu. I haven't had a fever in 20 years. I was the healthiest person I know. In fact, they had blocked regulation, so they were in phase one, below the level of being able to respond even to a viral infection with a low fever. And so they had chronic degenerative disease, which takes 10, 20, sometimes 30 years to manifest to a level and a size and degree.
Measurable.
Where it's detectable,
right.
Where it's noticeable. The symptoms, you get secondary symptoms of that. The tumor's pressing on something, it's visible, it's, you know, something's swelling.
I have a question about that. So if someone's not having any type of symptom at all, how do they know that something's going on? What would their sign roadmap look like if symptom in this dialogue is a sign of where you are, but I'm not having any symptoms, so I think I'm great?
Right, and that's why I'm saying this has to be in that 4%,
okay.
You know, that's like crucial to understand. If you think you're great,
this is the compass part.
Okay.
You think you're just fine, and you know, you go to your doctor for regular checkups, and they test, you know, 20 different chemicals in the blood or 20 different things about your blood, and those are all fine because those will be regulated until, you know, you could have a heart attack the next day, and they won't necessarily pick that up the day before.
You know, one of the things that happens with people in blocked regulation is all the people around them are frustrated with them.
Okay.
I think that's more than anything probably the road
signs.
Yeah,
if you have no problems,
you know, if everybody around you is saying, you know,
you.
Hey, you know, it's not cool for you to just eat McDonald's every day, and you know, it's not going to be healthy drinking all that soda and everything, and this person goes, you know, I have no problems at all, no symptoms.
But I like it.
Around here.
I love sugar. Tastes good.
Yeah,
I'm
right.
Not diabetic.
My coffee is just, I just like the taste of it. I don't need it. Right.
So it also maybe sounds like blocked regulation could be non-physical. It could be almost even situational, vibrational.
Often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's all
yeah.
The layers.
The nature of the function and regulation of the spirit and the consciousness and the function and regulation of the physical body is closely related. It's closely intertwined. If our physical immunity is down, if we're having problems with, you know, being able to tolerate the environment inside and out and what we eat, and there's usually a sensitivity to other people's thoughts and emotions and energies as well. or openness to other entities affecting us.
Maybe this is where you start talking about this, like around the whole compass part of this is where you start talking about the space and the matter and, you know, I guess you can talk about it anywhere.
I can.
I know, and you do, every chance.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got blocked regulation. Time is an issue, slightly. Yes,
yeah,
it
so
is.
So when the energy level comes up from that, when we start unblocking the regulation, well, what is it that blocks regulation? It's something that doesn't belong. It's a toxin.
A lot of times people with blocked regulation have blocked colon mm-hmm. or some kind of heart thing and end up on medication for blood pressure or something like that.
Yeah, and it's not all or none. We could have a certain aspect of regulation is blocked and not another. So we can, it's, you know, each of us is individual, but to understand the basic math.
It's not like your astrology sign, where here, you were born in this time.
Yeah, it's not unchangeable. But to change blocked regulation is one of the hardest things in the world, because you can't tell that you need to do anything. You think you're fine. You can't tell if you do the right thing or the wrong thing because there's no difference in symptoms. So you're really like without a clue, without a compass. You don't know there's a map. You just think you're in the center of the world and you know, cat's pajamas and life is good. Until suddenly everything falls apart and you have a heart attack, a stroke, a diagnosis of cancer. Those are the common things in our culture. And in fact, it didn't just happen to you. If you had the map and the compass, we could have seen that coming for 30 years and had 30 years to head it off. And that's probably plenty of time for most people, and that's what we do.
Okay, so after blocked regulation, what's
next? It's negative regulation. So the first thing that happens when you unblock that regulation, picture a pathway, a metabolic pathway in the body. Well, it's an enzyme. An enzyme is an amplifier of metabolism, of chemical reaction. So if you have a blocked enzyme, it means instead of having a vitamin or mineral nutrient in the center of that enzyme at the key spot to activate the reaction, you have the wrong thing. Maybe a heavy metal would be a common thing. So you have a heavy metal in there. When you unblock regulation, it means you knock that heavy metal out, often with a different metal that's less interfering, less blocking. Maybe a copper, gold, or silver atom knocks out an atom of mercury or lead or cadmium. And so the enzyme function goes from not happening to, ooh, there's a little function there. There's a little bit of, you know, energetic resonance with that enzymatic reaction that it's supposed to catalyze. And it's a step toward getting the exact little laser beam zinc that needs to be in there.
So what does a person experience then? In blocked regulation, they didn't feel anything.
What you experience primarily is that nasty heavy metal coming out of where it's blocking and storage into the bloodstream to get out of the body. And that feels as bad as when the heavy metal's going into the body because it's in the same place. So it's interfering with function sometimes throughout the body. So you have it could just be localized. Maybe you have a headache, or maybe you just feel, in Hawaii people say junk, you feel like crap because your body is moving. You've stirred up like a glass of water that had clay in the bottom and you've stirred it. And some of that clay is coming up into solution. You say, oh, that's nasty. I feel bad. So, but better out than in. It was blocking an important part of your body function. Now it's moving out, and that will pass, but it's a wave of symptoms that's telling you, that's going to reveal something about the nature of the toxin that you're moving out. If it's, if it comes out as pus and blood through the skin, maybe it's mercury, because mercury is very damaging to the blood vessels. If it creates a migraine headache, it's probably mercury. If it's coming out and itching, then maybe it's lead. That's a symptom of lead toxicity. So then there begin to be some signs of what's happening.
So these are more of the compass points, the itching,
right.
The blood in the pus.
And again, better out than in.
Right.
What direction is it pointing? If it's coming out the skin, it's coming out of your body. That's good. The skin is superficial. It's coming out. It's we can handle, or we can survive getting something bad out from ourselves, where all the action is of life, or out from the brain or the heart or the liver, these critical organs that we, or kidneys that we need to survive. If it's coming out through the feces, through the urine, through sweat. Through skin eruptions, it's coming out, and that's a good thing. So doesn't mean
so negative
we don't want to support that and
unpleasant.
You know, make it as pleasant as possible, help you ease through that, go quicker, easier. That's, you know, that's our job as well. But to get things out of the body that don't belong there, there's basically two possible causes for ill health. Having something that doesn't belong in excess, anything, you know, a bad thing is a bad thing, more of it, worse. and you can have even a little bit of a bad thing in a bad location, and that can be worse than even more of that in not as bad a location. So it's a changing pattern as we eliminate toxins from different parts of the body. But the other side of it is we can be missing the good thing. You know, when we get that heavy metal out of the enzyme, if it's mercury that has the same shape as zinc, then we need zinc in that enzyme to have it function. So we have the mercury in there is just blocking it. And maybe putting in gold, a trace amount of gold, knocks the mercury out because gold is an antidote for mercury. And having the gold in there, it's easier for the zinc to get in than when the mercury was in there. But so we might need to replete or supplement with zinc. We might need to supplement with gold, trace mineral therapy.
So what happens after negative regulation if they stick with it?
And we might need to supplement with something like glutathione that carries, that, you know, handcuffs the mercury and takes it out.
Mm-hmm. The bouncer,
yeah. We need binders of the toxins to help with elimination. We need catalysts that help trigger them to be eliminated. Solvents, sometimes that help dissolve them, like geranium. It's a wonderful solvent for mercury. So there's many possibilities, but the beauty is your body knows which one of those it needs. Mm-hmm. By resonance, this is epigenetics, the new science of epigenetics. It's really an old science called miasms and homeopathy for over 200 years. Our genetic material, we have all the genes in every cell, but different genes are active, and that's the only difference between a brain cell and a liver cell and a skin cell and an immune cell, is there's different genes that are turned on and turned off. And it's also the only difference between, at that level of the genetics, it's the difference between a cell that's healthy and a cell that's not healthy. They're in a different environment, which is stimulating the genes to turn on and turn off. So it's not that the genes are controlling it, it's that the genes are the library, and which books are open or closed to read from is controlled by the light, the environment of the cell, the resonance, the frequencies in the environment. So when we introduce a new frequency into the body, and the body responds with increased
meaning
coherence.
Meaning a new remedy of some sort?
It could be a frequency like in Hertz, an electromagnetic frequency. Mm-hmm. It could be a frequency like light, a color. Mm-hmm. It could be a frequency like every compound, every herb, vitamin, mineral, enzyme, hormone has specific resonance frequencies. And that's actually how they're measured in the laboratory. It's how we know what that thing is. It has a fingerprint in the electromagnetic spectrum. And so when we introduce that, say a medicine, and the body has a response of increased coherence, it goes, like our breath will go into coherence at 10 seconds per breath cycle, our heart will go into coherence at about 1 beat per second, our muscles and our brain will go into coherence in the alpha rhythm of 10 cycles per second, and there's many other functions that show these kind of coherence effects, where it's kind of like a magnet. If you get close to it, it draws it right in to that particular function. It's a natural function, just like a guitar string, a G string on a guitar. You pluck it, it has a natural resonance at that note, and that's why we hear it. It's resonating, and that energy is going, resonating the air, moving the air particles, and moving bones in our ears, and moving electrons in our brain. And that's all coherence of that frequency between the string, its physical nature, and the material and space between it and us and within us. And so that's what sensation is in my book, in my model. Sensation is a state of coherence across space-time. I pluck the string here now, boom, it's making a sound. And maybe I stop the string from making the sound, but there's a piano next to it that's now making that sound. The energy was transferred into the piano string.
Okay, how does this relate to anything?
So it's energy, coherent energy at that frequency that's now transmitted through space and time to another location, to another location in my ear, to another location in my brain, and my consciousness is projecting it out into space, in space and time, to the source, to the string on the guitar, or the string in the piano. So I'm hearing because there's a coherence of information, of frequency, of energy across space-time. There's this loop that's happening. And that's consciousness, that's perception.
Right? And how does that relate to negative regulation, which is what we're talking about?
In negative regulation...
We have 10 minutes left to finish the other three.
Okay. In negative regulation, there's symptoms. There's something that... There's some communication, some energy, some frequency that's traveling across space-time within the body, from one part of the body to another, as a sensation. I'm feeling pain in my ankles. Oh, they're swelling. I see them swelling. I can feel it. There's you know, increased fluid there. There's a symptom.
And okay, that's the negative regulation.
So that's the negative regulation.
What's the next one?
So the next level of regulation?
Yeah.
Is mixed regulation. Mixed regulation might be that, I unblocked that enzyme and I'm feeling itching in my skin and maybe irritation in my bladder. I'm having frequency and urgency and the lead's coming out these ways. But I also notice that I'm sleeping better.
No more migraines.
No more migraines. Mm-hmm. Or, yeah, something positive and with something negative is a mix. And then there's positive regulation and optimum regulation, where we do better with doing the right thing or do great when we do the right thing. And that's where life works. That's how life is supposed to work. That's how we're supposed to be. And that's what we know from when we were younger, when we had less accumulated layers of toxins built up that we weren't able, or trauma or damage built up, or our own stress responses built up that we weren't able to process and clear in real time. So now we're like an agate, layers built up. And so
cool.
Yeah, ideally, yeah, like we get back to that point.
So
where
we've got
we've
got the blocked and nothing's happening. We get then we get that unblocked, and then there can be some negative symptomatic, not feeling junk,
but healing crisis,
and then,
where we come out of it feeling better than we did before. Have a fever for 3 days, and after the fever, feel, wow, I haven't felt this good in 10 years. This feels like I did when I was 18. I feel like I'm a kid. And there'll be new symptoms that come up that will relate to that past time that you're now. So healing is really, in homeopathy, it's called retracing. It's a journey in time, a reverse time. We're reaching back into older, deeper issues that we didn't completely heal at the time in the past.
So that's part of the compass as well, then, is a reflection on past issues that may have been suppressed.
I recognize this road. When I was a kid, I took this road, but I was going the other direction.
I haven't felt this way since I was 12.
I'm heading back home. I know where I am.
Well, a lot of people think, when that happens to them, think, oh no, this old thing has come back,
right,
and that's
terrible.
It's
back again.
Oh no.
Right.
But like when people, if you have the roadmap orientation, you're thinking that way, your consciousness is focused on the fact that this is part of the journey, you won't be so
classic,
freaked out about it.
Classic one that any smoker needs to know. When you quit smoking, about 6 months after you quit, if you don't do a cleanse to pull the nicotine out of your tissues at the time, at about 6 months, typically, your body gets strong enough to start cleansing the nicotine that's in storage. And it can stay there the rest of your life, but your body wants it out if it can. And when it starts moving it out, it's going to be in your bloodstream, and you'll have cravings. You'll have the same symptoms as you did when you were smoking, and that's when most smokers go back to smoking. It's like, oh, I'm craving it. Yeah. Might as well
just
smoke. Can't
fight the craving.
Yeah.
So what else would you... now, we've got the compass and we've got the map. What would be the other two things?
The other two things is now, what do I do about it? Because there's technologies and there's remedies. You know, there's material things that you can put in your body to support and restructure and help cleanse. You know, medicines, remedies, foods, things that you put in your body. And there's things that you can use to modify the environment, for water, air, light, to clean up the environment, things mm-hmm. to avoid toxins mm-hmm. in the environment. So the technologies and the actual remedies for
and what you said earlier about the remedies, that it's important of the source of the remedy. So I wouldn't want to just go down to Walgreens and get some vitamin C.
Yeah, I've actually measured two different bottles of vitamin C from another chain store. And they measured different. The body responded okay. One was okay energetically. You know, it's not a great brand. It's not, I know, you know, it's like low, the lowest possible quality. And the company that, you know, that's having it made for them in their private label, you know, doesn't really care about quality. But one of them was okay energetically for that person at that time. And the other one was just not good. Other than that, I don't know why it was not good, but looking closely at the bottles, even though it was the same product, same company, same brand, they were different batches. And you could tell from the label being slightly different, nominally the same, same barcode, same, it's the same product, same UPC code. So nominally
okay,
same,
so,
but made
so
by a different manufacturer for
saying,
that private label.
Yeah. So what you're saying is that you need your compass, you need your map, and you need
you
the
need
nutrients.
Your you need your backpack, right?
Your backpack
with you. You need a few things. You need, you're going to need food,
uh-huh.
and you're going to need some tools.
Right.
You know, because you're going to run into, you know, maybe you need to build a fire, so you need a saw and something, a fire
okay,
starting
so whatever
kit.
The tools
matches.
Are, whatever the tools
water,
are and the
need,
nutrients that you need.
Yeah. You need air. You
What's
need water.
The fourth thing? Just to sum
well, that
this
was,
up.
That was the fourth.
Oh, what was the third?
The food.
Okay.
And the tools.
Was the food and
you know,
the tools?
You need your water. You need your water.
Yeah,
you need your flashlight.
That.
You need
I don't
your...
know what the four things are. I've got the compass, the map, now the nutrients. Mm-hmm. What is the fourth one?
Tools.
Okay, gotcha.
You need your Swiss Army knife at least.
I love it. This is awesome. Right. This is
it's
a great.
It's
thing.
The survival kit.
Yes.
Because you know what.
It's the survival kit for the wizards.
Yeah, and even if, you know, if
wizards
even
of
if
wellness.
Even if you're smart enough, aware enough to realize that the world, you know, we rely on the world as it is, and we think that it's, you know, it's great that we can go down to the drugstore and buy aspirin to get rid of that headache, and the studies show that taking aspirin for a headache increases the likelihood of having another headache and another headache, and it makes chronic headaches out of acute headaches. So it's great for aspirin sales, great for the pharmaceutical companies, the most lucrative companies in the planet. But it's not great for your health. It's suppressive. It stops your body from healing. It over-alkalizes. It turns this solution that your body's trying to dissolve and clean out into a gel with the aspirin along with it, so now it's even more toxic.
So how would you but, sum this up?
So the point I'm getting to is that realize that what would happen here on Hawaii Island? What happens if there's either a natural disaster, which like all it would take is a solar coronal mass ejection to knock out shipping to the island? How long would there be aspirin on the shelves? About a week. How long would there be food on the shelves in the stores? About a week. So, you know, if you can, or there could be a man-made disaster. World War III breaks out. Do you think the ships are going to bring food and medicine to this island? Or could there be something that disrupts it? All it would take is one ship in the Strait of Hormuz to block the whole shipping of oil from the Middle East. So to be prepared for navigating these terrains of health, not only in the world as we know it today, but in with greater flexibility to be able to have that backpack,
yes, exactly,
survival pack,
exactly,
to, you know, could you go out in nature and not only survive, but thrive? Take care of yourself, heal the people around you. That would be a wonderful goal to be able to achieve, you know, the security, the sense of security, and just the fact of being able to heal yourself and heal the people around you, heal your loved ones. You know, in an unstable world, the best thing you could do to create stability around yourself is to be able to heal yourself and others, to create an environment that's conducive to life where that's
so ultimately
entropy effect
at some point, what you're saying, what I think you're saying, is that at some point all these things may be training wheels and won't need that in order to facilitate healing.
Yeah, here's an example.
By using consciousness,
like let's say
and focused intention.
Let's say I'm
like you were saying in the beginning about the saints being able to just do miracles.
Yeah. If we can create, and I believe we can, if we can create an environment that is perfectly optimal for health, we literally don't need to eat food. We don't have damage happening to our bodies. If we're perfectly healthy, our body's not breaking down. We know that there's a second pathway for energy to run the process of life through quantum energy, through light. So in a perfect cosmic environment or a perfect local environment even, our physical bodies, our biological bodies become immortal. That's not that shouldn't be our ultimate only end goal. Our knowing that our spirit is immortal and can regenerate the physical body in a new environment is enough. Over the geological time scale of our genetics, we are adapted for a wide range of cosmic energy states on the planet. In some of those states, our lifespan is much, much longer, where we can receive our energy directly from the environment, where we don't need to eat other species. We don't need to kill to live, because the environment is an environment of life. We're in a challenging time now, and that may change. In the change process, it may become more challenging, like negative regulation, before it becomes better. There's certainly blockage in the system.